Hi, I'm Pat Ryan. Welcome to Chicago Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's new digital startup hub. We have a special guest tonight, John Aiello, the co-founder of SAVO. In the interest of full disclosure, I have to tell you, I think John's advice is so great that I have him on the board of not one but two of the companies we started. So, well, I don't have any ownership in SAVO. I wish I did. And this is really great. It shows you John's a great director, a great entrepreneur, and a great friend of entrepreneurs in Chicago here. So we're really glad to have you.
Thank you very much.
So just to start off, for the people who don't know SAVO, what does SAVO do?
SAVO's in the business of making salespeople more effective. I mean, at the very simplest level. If you think of ever selling anything in your life, which hopefully all those entrepreneurs out there are thinking exclusively about selling stuff with their whole life, you need a lot of stuff. You need a lot of information. You need access to content, to people, to insight, to best practices. SAVO's in the business. It's a SaaS company. Through and through, we have north of 1 million users of our software now globally across probably 300 customers, major corporations and their sales organizations. I like to describe it from the life of a salesperson who's preparing for a meeting, who's trying to find the right PowerPoint, the right case study, the right subject matter expert in their organization, maybe halfway around the world. How do you push that information to these people when they need it most in the context of a selling opportunity? That's what SAVO does, and we call it sales enablement. At the end of the day, it's making salespeople smarter so they don't have to spend a lot of time doing wasted energy type stuff of finding information, and they can focus on the interaction of selling, which is where the magic happens.
That's exciting. So for the uninitiated, how would it be different than the way someone might use a Salesforce.com?
I would say it's very complementary to Salesforce.com or the CRM category in general. If you think about it, CRM is a very critical part of an organization. It tends to have value for the management organization. I mean, we use CRM, we use Salesforce.com at SAVO, and we use it religiously and well. But it's really a tool for salespeople to communicate up the ladder of what's going on in their territory, what's going on in their pipeline, ultimately used in most cases for forecasting and projecting. We flip-flop it. The value of SAVO is quite the converse. It's all about the salesperson. How do you make that sales individual, he or she, more effective in what they do so the pipeline they're forecasting through CRM is actually going to happen? Okay. And by the way, fully integrated into all CRMs so that if you're in an opportunity record inside of Salesforce.com, and you're saying, I need to call Bob Smith today because I'm at stage two in my sales cycle, SAVO will automatically push you all the right stuff that you need for that conversation. Major time savings for salespeople, and you get to replicate what your very best people do in some of your newer people as well.
That's exciting. That makes a big difference.
It's very powerful. Salespeople love it, and that's usually a difference between CRM, quite honestly, Pat. They love to use SAVO.
CRM, most implementations Salesforce are, we won't pay you unless it's in there.
Well, and that's always, I'm a big believer in the stick and the carrot.
Now, it's interesting, looking at what SAVO does, and one of the things we talk about in entrepreneurship, and Mark Andreessen is a big proponent of, is, startups think so much about product, which is important, but go to market and, getting sales. We were on a board call today, and John said, I think only 95% of your focus has to be on sales right now. You could do everything else in the other 5% of time, because there are times when you're in a startup, you really have to focus. You have to get that market traction. And I think product is so critical. You have to have the right product to sell. Making salespeople effective, boy, for all of us, it's like engineers. And a salesperson who's really good is 5x what an average one
Absolutely.
Is. And you guys obviously raise the bar for everybody. It's a cool idea, you're having a big impact, but where does an idea like that come from? You guys coined the term sales enablement technology.
We did. We actually didn't coin that till we were in business for about 6 years, so we were slow on the coining of terms. Honestly, it started in the trenches. I was a young marketer coming out of Kellogg, which is where I first met Pat, plug for the folks up north here, and went to the Miller Brewing Company. And was one of the brand managers for Miller Lite. And I had a great mentor up there, a guy named Mike Johnson, who said, Aiello, marketing is really, really critical, but if you don't help salespeople sell stuff, you stink. Actually, he used different language, but for the purpose of tonight, I'll say that. So he said, your first job as a marketer is to not be here for the next 90 days. Go build some credibility in the field. Go understand how programs get localized and actually how we move boxes. This was a brilliant marketer, in my opinion, ahead of his time. And this was a guy that was a mentor for me. So I learned very early to really understand the sales world, to respect the differences between sales and marketing, but to understand as a marketer just walking around corporate with your beautiful shiny ad or the new Miller Lite can, which by the way was really cool, isn't going to get the job done. It's right. How did we get the Memorial Day display? How did we sell more boxes through Safeway? How did we get distribution in the major chains? That type of stuff. So that's where it started. And what I realized was we kind of stunk at it, Pat. It was pretty brutal. I'd see salespeople out there creating presentation decks for their big meetings at the big chain stores, and it had like a logo from like 5 years ago. It had stuff that we didn't do anymore. Quite honestly, the brand of Miller Lite, while I called myself a brand manager, was everything but in my control. And so I said, something's got to change on that. When I left Miller, I went to run marketing and sales for a large home builder, publicly traded home builder in Chicagoland, and actually had both marketing and sales reporting up to me in that role, and I learned again how critical it was to make sure that sales and marketing were intertwined and closely knit. SAVO was born out of a frustration that I had. It was a frustration as a marketer that we spend an incredible amount of money creating stuff, content, brochures. Today it's digital stuff. We spend all this money, energy, time, mindshare creating stuff, and then we throw it over the transom to sales and kind of, come on, use it. I hope it works. You know, occasionally we'll call a sales guy, the best guy, hey, what'd you use? Hey, that was good. There's no empirical data about what actually works. So that was the frustration from the marketing side. Plus, salespeople tended to think we were a bunch of head in the clouds, let's go do another offsite type marketing folks. From the sales side, I was frustrated because marketing people didn't use the language that I used. They didn't understand our sales process. Okay, they didn't understand exactly what I needed at the right time. They were creating things that felt good in corporate. So that was the frustration. And I said, you know what, there's a problem to be solved here. But I think the first lesson in terms of how, our first thought in terms of how I started SAVO was we didn't have it all figured out. We didn't start this as a SaaS company. We started as a consulting company. I was fortunate enough and blessed, and hopefully you all will be as blessed as I was, to find a co-founder, the likes of Drew Larson, who some of my SAVO gang over here knows very well. Brilliant man, brilliant technologist, who, by the way, doesn't like technology. He likes applying it. And I said, Drew, I got a really big problem that I think we can solve. He said, I think we can try and learn how to solve it. And together, we did consulting for the first 2.5 years at SAVO exclusively. And we went and learned the problem in the trenches. We were fortunate to be here in Chicago. Our first client was Citicorp Diners Club, then the Northern Trust, then LaSalle Bank. And I'll tell you, after we'd landed Citicorp Diners Club, I said, we've got a financial services practice. We didn't even have a brochure ourselves, but I certainly sold that very hard into some of these other organizations. And we learned about this problem from our customers. And eventually we said to ourselves, when the same type of organization asks us for something twice in 1 month, we're going to try and build a product. And we built a product in 2002. So we were SaaS before SaaS was cool. I think it was like us and Salesforce.com. I'm pretty sure it was pretty much it.
So talk a little bit about that first client. How'd you get the first consulting client? And then we could talk a little bit about the first technology client, the first SaaS client.
Well, first of all, I looked really sad and hungry and told them how much I really needed revenue. Revenue, by the way, is the only thing I'll ever talk to entrepreneurs about. If you have revenue, don't worry about your board and your governance. Actually sell something. Now you're an entrepreneur. My belief is that first customer, you have to do anything you can. Anything you can. I was fortunate to have a network of my Kellogg classmates. Obviously, here's one of the most accomplished. But some of my classmates had moved on into some pretty senior ranks. Sent out a note and said, hey, listen, I just started something. Here's kind of what we're going to try and do. Would you give me a few minutes to sort of investigate what you're looking for? And I think I was a pretty natural sales guy, sort of a marketer by training, sales guy by DNA. And I understood the concept of discovery and trying to probe for unmet needs and pain. And we found out that there was a major pain at Citicorp Diners Club at the time, which was they were hemorrhaging existing clients. They needed to sort of create a retention program to maintain these folks. And their account execs were out trying to do PowerPoint presentations, and it was taking them 2 months to even put a presentation together. It was an incredible waste of time. And of course, as any good entrepreneur does, I said, well, what if we recreated your content for you? And then what if we built a technology that could automate that whole thing? And of course, the what if question led to a absolutely, and then Drew kicked me under the table and said, you idiot, I don't know how we're gonna do that. And what do you know? We started a little company off of an unmet need. We built a one-off technology, sat actually in our office on a server that with one click of a button, pulled data from 10 different sources and created an automated PowerPoint presentation in seconds that allowed these account managers not to focus their time on a presentation, but focus it on their customer, which is really where the magic happened. And then it was interesting because that need was something that I lived and something that every customer we would go talk to, and still to this day, I guarantee you the SAVO sales organization, which is infinitely larger than anything I ever knew before, every meeting, that type of need will resonate with people. So it was just a real need. We were ambitious. We were hungry. Frankly, we did anything we could do to get a break. I will tell you, I was very fortunate to sell my first deal to a friend. I remember handing over my proposal with shaking hands. thinking, are they going to say yes to this thing? And she looked at me and says, I think you might be missing a zero on that. I was like, yes, you're right. I am missing it. So, you know, selling to friends, making them look good. And by the way, that first project was so incredibly unprofitable, I can't even begin to think about it. And I would recommend that to everybody, way over-deliver, because you know what? I had a logo on our slide deck now, and that was a referenceable client from
and
day
you
one.
You probably learned a ton.
Yeah, an enormous amount. And it was real-world learning. It wasn't whiteboard, it wasn't boardroom. It was just out there in the trenches learning.
Right. So you do your original programming team? Did he program this stuff early on? So
yeah, I was the sales guy, content creator, and client management, and Drew was the developer, coder, architect, and by the way, a brilliant sales guy as well. We're a pretty good selling team.
So talk a little bit about the idea of having a co-founder, a little bit about how you guys connected as a team and that experience and your thoughts on it.
So this was not our first entrepreneurial venture, Savo. Drew and I, he was the rhythm guitarist, and I was the lead singer of Rocks, Paper, Scissors, and a 1980 covers band at the University of Illinois. We didn't make a lot of money.
I did not know that.
Yes.
Any YouTube videos?
Will you still keep me on your board?
Only
yes,
if you
yes I did have my ear pierced. It was the 80s. Goo goo gaga. Anyways, Drew and I had known each other for a long, long time. There was an incredible amount of mutual respect. Literally, when I graduated from college and began grad school, Drew knocked on my door. He was in Europe for a couple years doing consulting, technology consulting. He needed a place to stay for a couple nights, and he stayed, of course, for 3 years on my living room floor until we both got married. We got to watch each other's careers evolve. We got to watch what we were doing, and so we would collaborate a little bit. What I would tell you is there was an incredible amount of mutual respect. There was an incredible amount of inherent trust. Okay, most of the corporations, probably young corporations, are S corporations, right? 50-50 split in an S corporation. You better know everything about the other individual because you're like blood brothers, and in fact, we were. But the trust was there from day one, so I never had to worry about Drew. And here's the biggest thing I would tell you. If you have a co-founder, and I strongly recommend it, we defined excellent the same way. I think co-founding partnerships get into trouble when somebody defines excellent up here and somebody defines excellent up here, because inevitably there's going to be something in the gray area here where one of them says, I did a great job, and the other one says, yeah, no, it stunk. Okay, Drew and I had an extraordinarily high definition of excellence, and it was the same. I would say the other thing that worked about Drew and I is we understood from day one two things. Number one, he was Mr. Inside, I was Mr. Outside. While we each owned 50% of the company, when it was something related to revenue generation, customer relations, I owned 51%. And it was something inside, he owned 51%. And that led to great debate, great, sometimes loud debate. I am Italian. And then ultimately led to a unified front when we walked out, when we started having employees. So we handled conflict well. It's like a marriage. And if you're intentional about your marriage and finding the right partnership, a co-founder is absolutely the same way. Drew would tell you that.
Got it. Great. Well, so let's step back for a minute. We heard about the 80s rock. I've known you for a long time. I won't say how long.
If you want our set list, I could probably.
I just want to see a YouTube video of it. It's got to be there somewhere.
They've been cleansed. I have children now.
So talk a little bit about, you know, where you're from, where you grew up, kind of early. You know, what was your experience like as a kid?
Yeah.
How did that impact sort of what you've done with your life?
I'm one of six kids. Grew up in Arlington Heights, Illinois. Haven't strayed too far. In fact, I live in Arlington Heights. And I live a block away from the high school I went to. St. Vider, give it up, Vider boys. Thank you. My dad was an entrepreneur. My dad was in real estate. My dad started his own residential real estate business in probably the late 60s. And I would say, as one of six kids, one of four boys, very competitive environment. So I will tell you there's a competitive spirit. I hate to lose.
Where do you fall?
I'm the fourth brother, so I lost a lot, just to be clear about that. I also was humbled quite a bit in terms of my big brothers, who are all great athletes and all this type of stuff. You know what? Growing up in a big family, I think communication became important. I think sometimes entrepreneurs way underestimate the importance of how they communicate. To be able to be humble, likable, smart, eloquent, able to communicate, able to relate to people who are C-level, and able to relate to their administrative assistants, and do it genuinely as opposed to kind of like you're acting. Communication was a big part of my family, I think a big part of who I am today. My dad's entrepreneurial experience was inspiring to me, but I got to tell you, even through high school at Vider, went to the University of Illinois, I went back and worked at St. Vider High School, which was a fascinating experience, sort of learned marketing and selling a service and a product that I was very passionate about. I never knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur. In fact, I went to Kellogg, well, this was all pre-internet that Pat and I went to Kellogg. Not much pre-internet.
They introduced email our second.
I remember, well, I was looking at dude, that's really cool, you can send stuff.
The only problem is you had to go home, or you had to go to school and get like a, you know.
Yeah, I know.
So you could get it like once a day.
It's funny because I'm now teaching a class at Kellogg, and these students walk in, they're like, you still email stuff? Like, just tweet it, you know? I'm like, okay. So, anyways. I didn't know I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I never took an entrepreneurship class to my recollection. I was an entrepreneur, quite honestly, because what was happening in my field that I'm very passionate about was brutally frustrating. And as a competitive person, and I think the other thing, I had some experiences in my career where while the founders and the entrepreneurs that started those organizations and the mentors were wonderful people, I always wanted to love it when my customers called, quite honestly. The home building business is where I cut my teeth a little bit in some of this world as well. It's not one where you typically like to hear from your customers very much. It's usually you did something wrong. And so part of the motivation for me was I want to be in a business where when my customer calls, I'm psyched and where I can sort of create that culture of collaboration with them early on. So I don't know, those are some of the early things.
That's exciting. Well, tell me, so, you know, we try and talk about a few themes here just because every entrepreneur has his or her own experience. We talked about your founding story, your kind of founder market fit, which, by the way, is a lot like Brian Johnson's from Braintree. When Brian was here, he talked about they were in a services business that caused them to see the need and became a technology. So.
And that's not an easy thing. I mean, we probably got to $4 million in revenue as a consulting business.
Wow.
And probably 15 some odd employees. And we're a great consulting business, but Drew and I knew that business model did not scale. And frankly, it didn't really solve the problem in a grand way like we wanted to. And so the conversion from a services business where, quite honestly, you get addicted to that revenue and the cash flow. And by the way, we bootstrapped the company from 99 until 2005. So we didn't raise money until 6 years into the business. That consulting business made us smarter, I think, informed the nature of the product. But it was tough to change. It was tough to become a product company, to tell your customers no. It's not on our roadmap right now, you know.
So talk a little bit about that, because I think one of the harder things to do as an entrepreneur is this idea of product market fit. You know, how do you figure out the right product? Because it's easy in here. You talk about it here, and it seems easy, and I was laughing with some of our guys in our labs group about, you know, you end up in this situation where you're like, oh, but we should do this, and they can do this. And, you know, products, by definition, mushroom. People have lots of opinions.
Yep.
And so figuring out how to really nail the product is as much art as anything else. Mm-hmm. Talk about your all's experience of how did you figure out the right product? How did you figure out what the optimal product was? You know, what were the sort of things that you learned and that would guide you if you did it again?
Yep. Well, here's the cool thing about your question, Pat, is you ask it as if we figured out the ideal product already. It's dynamic, so we haven't. I mean, we have an incredible team today focusing on how do we continue moving toward the ideal product. As long as businesses change, as long as the world of sales changes, we'll never have the ideal product, and I'm really happy because
yes.
It keeps us on edge.
But the critical mass.
No,
you
I
got the critical mass,
so,
people
so,
like, I got to own that
yeah,
product.
No, so it starts with, in my opinion, a real burning passion for solving a problem that you can clearly articulate and understanding who specifically has that problem. In our world, that was a salesperson. Okay, the challenge is, of course, you sell to the head of sales or to the head of marketing or the head of sales operations. They may verbalize the problem one way. The people that report up into them, the actual salespeople, would probably verbalize it somewhat differently.
So talk a little bit about that. I mean, talk about the idea of having we have this in some of our businesses, a decision maker and a user that are distinct and figuring out what to build and what the right product is.
Both very important, by the way, because we need contracts to get paid. So decision makers are very critical. Here's what I learned. First of all, I loved selling to sales and marketing people. And so if you love who you're selling to and you've lived in their shoes for a little while, you're going to have some built-in advantages. Okay, so we were able to speak the language of the decision maker, and we were able to not come off as salespeople but as consultants and practitioners, but as really smart about the problem. Frankly, we educated these folks about a problem that they wouldn't be able to verbalize themselves. So we won the decision makers over And I think what that gave us was the license to go do discovery with their people. So we went in early days, we called what we did sales asset management. In 2004, 2005, we began calling it sales enablement. And believe me, still to this day, we'll walk into a sales meeting and say, we do sales enablement, and people go, what? So there was an education process. But the smarts that we had, I think, around the space, the ability to anticipate the need because we knew it very well, allowed the decision makers to say these people are credible. Then we would go out and do discovery with the actual feet on the street, the people who are selling, the content creators in an organization. And we could come back with a very tailored to the company type of solution. So we kind of used a consulting selling process to sell a SaaS solution. I always say to this day, our product is, I don't think SAVO is a SaaS company. I don't think there's such a thing as a SaaS company. You don't sell SaaS. You solve a solution to a problem somebody has. SaaS is a distribution model. Mm-hmm. Okay? That distribution model made sense for us because we sold to sales and marketing people who don't want to hear about capital expenditure. They have operating expense budgets. So we were SaaS before it was cool. To me, you win the heart and the mind of the person, and then you go out and you solve the problem tailored. And we were selling to big organizations. I mean, to this day, you know, IBM, American Express, Citi, JP Morgan Chase.
So talk for a minute, companies. Were you replacing something?
Generally, occasionally. Occasionally, and early on, we had to be, because it was a new category, still to this day, so much evangelistic selling. People aren't sure that you don't just call them up and say, hey, what are you using today for sales
enablement?
That's
what I want to talk about. I think the evangelical sale tends to be a slower, it's a snowball, but people forget the snowball, how small it starts.
Yeah.
And talk about establishing a new category, the challenges and opportunities of evangelical sale, and how you guys did that. Because it's hard. I mean, it sounds great once you're successful.
Yeah.
But a lot of companies have died along the way, not getting far enough, fast enough to make it work.
I may be a contrarian in this. I don't know. I think if you're out there today, you're starting a company, and you're thinking of creating a category, I think you're wasting your time out of the gate. Create customers. Okay, build credibility, validate those customer stories through third parties. Now you can start talking about a category. If you go out and try and evangelize a category before you have real life success in doing what you think you can do, I think you're making a mistake. I think you're going to spend a lot of time and energy. So from 99, when we started as a consulting company, 2003, we ultimately launched our SaaS application. We really didn't start talking about a category until 2005. And part of it was, when we went out to raise money, we had to kind of frame this up, and people said, what do you do? You know, what we did early on, do anything you can do to get your first customers. And I can tell you, spend an hour on different ideas there. But when you have that, I recommend strongly doing third-party case study validation of those. We went out and we hired a firm in 2003, or 2004, called Nucleus Research, that focused on analyzing and quantifying in an objective manner the ROI that companies got from doing technology initiatives. They did one early on for, I think, AmerisourceBergen, one of our early clients, for ADP. And they, you know, they had this like 470% ROI payback inside of 3 months. And it was their logo, not ours. And that became an incredible selling asset for us. It got us in the door to any organization. And suddenly we now had a research firm and an analyst firm asking us more about the space because they didn't see that type of ROI a lot. And it was around that time that we said, you know, maybe we ought to go do a briefing for Gartner. Maybe we ought to go start talking about things. But we were way along the curve before we started thinking about creating a category. I just think that there's some buzzwords that we focus on too much as entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk a little bit about selling in where you're not replacing something, which is evangelical by nature.
Yeah.
Because it's always easier to get somebody to say, see your flip phone here?
Yeah.
I got a smartphone for you. Yeah. Let me tell you why I want a smartphone. That's easier because you're spending money on something. When, you know, you didn't have that.
Right. So this is a two-edged sword, right, I think. Because when you're actually doing the selling and you're trying to win the heart and the commitment and the contract of somebody, you have to make it clear that there's nothing else like you, that there's no one like you, that there's never been, never going to be, and you know all that great stuff, right? And no one's as tall, charming, and handsome either. So you need to do that. But then because it's an evangelistic sale, guess what? They don't have anything budgeted for it.
Right, exactly.
So you have to find things that they can replace to actually find budget. So we were in this dance constantly talking about, you know, this new space and really empowering sellers, and yeah, you've got a portal, but that doesn't do this, and yeah, you've got an intranet, that doesn't do it, and oh, you bought this little proposal creation tool, yeah, they don't even use that. So we would distance ourselves from them, and then as fast as we distance ourselves, as soon as we knew that we had something on the line, it was absolutely, let's replace those things. The 10 grand you spend a year, we can replace that. So it is a dance a little bit, mm-hmm. And by the way, the dance won't be the same in any two customers for many, many years. So you got to be agile. You got to be a good salesperson.
Be an athlete. Be an athlete. There you go. So what year was it that SAVO growth really took off, that you, the curve shifted in a dramatic way?
I think one of the cool things about SAVO, truthfully, now I haven't seen a lot more companies having been involved in the CEC. SAVO consistently, and I may be off a percent or two, we've been in business for 14 years, almost 14 years. Every single year, we've had at least 30% growth. So this wasn't like, you know, and then, you know. It's been very consistent, and you start compounding the growth percentage.
But I remember when you had won the Momentum Award,
yeah.
And when you and I caught up a couple years later,
yeah.
It was a, you were, well, no. So you I said were at least,
I said at least
company.
30%, yeah. Right? So percentages are good friends. at least 30%. So truthfully, we launched the SaaS product in 2003, and the growth was enormous in those next couple years, 2003 to 2005, to the point where we were bootstrapping the company. Up until that time, we went out to raise money, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit, in 2004, which became a full-time job for me. And by the way, our worst year of growth, 2004, when I was raising money full-time. By raising money, infusing new capital in the business, we built a data center, we rebuilt our entire technology, and the years from 06 to 09 were incredible growth. We started to scale out our sales organization, started to replicate some of the things that I'd been doing early on. And then, you know, what's been fascinating is there's never been like one of these, though. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a couple reasons for that. Number one, we are fans of selling. It's what we do. We help organizations sell better, so we're good at it, I believe. Can always be better. If you're watching out there, SAVO salesperson, you can do better. Always do better. The other thing is, historically, we've had way higher than SaaS industry norm of customer retention. Mm-hmm. I mean, up until probably 2008 or so, it was 100% retention. And it's always been north of 93, 94, 98%, somewhere in there every year.
Number.
So if you think about it, if you do a good job of selling, and you do a really good job of making your customers successful, okay, we call it customer success, which is I think what you should call it, you start the year prepped for growth. I mean, everything you sell incrementally is gonna be growth. So. The couple things, when we scaled our technology, the early technology that we built was still built from a consulting mentality, Pat. I call it a mansion by way of room addition. Okay? We had all these consulting clients, and of course we were in the habit of doing everything they asked for. So when this customer said, I need this, we say, absolutely. And when this customer said, oh yeah, that's on our roadmap. And we had this behemoth of a technology which was incredibly innovative but awfully burdensome. In fact, it was like a SaaS application that took 3 months to deploy. Kind of defeating the idea of SaaS applications. When we raised money in 2005, Drew and I are always paranoid people. We've always been paranoid people. Again, I think a good trait for entrepreneurs. We decided to put ourselves out of business before someone else did. And so we wanted to build this faster, slicker, easy to implement. And so we rebuilt the entire application, rebranded the product to the name of SAVO, and launched it in that way. And that was mansion by intention. And that was great because now we had a powerful enterprise caliber software tool that could be deployed within hours.
Talk about scaling the other parts of your organization. How do you, you know, when you guys started to grow in people, how did that change what you needed to do as an entrepreneur, as a CEO, and what'd you learn and what worked?
Well, first of all, I would say the journey of scaling your organization as a founder is a very personal journey. I can't express that enough. You go from being the founder, the everything, Drew and I picking up phones, getting water for everybody, I mean, everything, to suddenly, I didn't want to be a CEO. I didn't start out this thing to be a CEO. Suddenly you're a CEO of a corporation, and now you're being looked at as a CEO, you know, and I'm getting a little higher heels, so I looked a little taller and played the part a little bit and painted some gray hair on, which is now very natural, but I absolutely had no desire to be a CEO. That wasn't my goal. So the scaling of the organization as an entrepreneur, I would just tell you, it's a wonderful journey, but it's a scary one. You have to continue to redefine yourself like every single day. And that in and of itself is wonderful. On that front, and I'll come to the scaling of the company, I found some counsel. I joined something at the time, it was called Vistage. I found other CEOs that I could collaborate with. You are all so blessed that you have 1871, okay, and a resource here that wasn't here when I was kind of growing this company. And learned from other CEOs how to be a good CEO and took some challenges and one-on-one counseling and people who weren't afraid to tell me I was full of it. And that's a great, you know, refining tool for CEOs. So scaling of myself was a whole journey, and of Drew. The scaling of the company, I would say, at the end of the day, it really comes down to what your philosophy is on hiring, okay? Because, you know, when you start out a company, you're so passionate, you better be passionate. Everything you're doing, you're bleeding it, and then you gotta bring in an employee, right? And that's a scary endeavor. I mean, I remember the first employee we had, I mean, this person was a third of the company. How do you screen for those people? How do you really understand if they can function in an entrepreneurial environment? So take your time, hire slow, fire fast, you're gonna make mistakes, but then find people who are great in your organization of identifying and recruiting great talent. I mean, to this day, SAVO wouldn't be close to where it is today if it weren't for some of the very early hires we made in the early 2000s. And so you gotta do it wisely, and you're gonna make mistakes, and that's part of scaling yourself.
Yeah, it makes sense. We talk about it, you get to a certain point. We did an interview with one of our key people in Max today, and we came back from here. She said, no, this isn't the right, but this person wouldn't fit here. And when you get to that level of people understand what that means,
yep.
I think it allows you to not have to be the entrepreneur, chief bottle washer, everything else. People. Yeah.
I'll give one little point of advice. I'm a little bit of a contrarian to some of the typical entrepreneurial axioms, like it's all about culture. I don't think it's all about culture. I think at some point your company will scale that you don't create the culture, you enable it, you sort of set the tone for it, right? And I would say if doing it all over again, the one thing I think we did really well, we didn't do it perfectly, but we did it really well, we were able to identify people who actually treated our company as if it were their own. Because inevitably when you're in a small company, people are put in positions that are probably way above where they should be at that age. But you know what, when they treat the company like it's their own, they watch the money that's spent, they look out for the customers as if they were their own, and of course you share the company with them, it creates a culture in and of itself. And I think it's a little bit too ambitious for CEOs to think I'm constantly gonna be in control of this culture. You're not, and that's half the fun. Mm-hmm. Hire people who are smarter than you, who can take your vision and make it bigger, okay, and who you enjoy being around, and who enjoy your customers.
So, speaking of employment, you decided at some point, that you had been CEO for a long time, and the right move for you personally, and the right move for the organization was for you not to be CEO.
That's correct.
Now, talk about that story, that decision. That's a big decision.
Yeah.
At least you know for the company.
Yeah.
And I'm sure for you. Talk a little bit about, I mean, you and I went through this together,
yep.
On a lot of those, but, you know, share that, because I think it's an important
sure.
moment, especially in businesses like in the B2B world where SaaS companies take longer to build. It's not like Instagram where you sell it for $1 billion next year. These things take time.
Right.
And so it is a marathon. It's like an Ironman.
Well, for sure. That's a good analogy. You know, first of all, I'll segue into that. I believe that entrepreneurs ought to do everything they can do to raise money when they don't need it. I also believe you ought to do everything you can do to find your replacement when you don't need to. Okay, so let me go back. So I started SAVO with Drew. He's a year older than me, so I want to point out he's the older of the two of us. I'm 44 now, so I would have been about 30, 31. And I'm just an all-in type of person, and I hope all of you out there are just all-in, because it's no fun if you're dabbling in stuff, okay? So you gotta go all in, and whether you succeed or fail, all in is the only way you wanna look back at it. It's draining, man. It is draining. My first son was born 11 years ago. My second one was born 7 years ago. And I'm in the midst of building this wonderful company with great people, and I'm gone a lot. You know, so part of the personal part of it was, is this what I wanna do with my 40s? I've done this with my 30s. Do I wanna be present? Do I wanna be a part of my kids' lives? Or do I wanna be, you know, hey, thanks, good to see you again, honey. I gotta, you know, head on a plane. And quite honestly, it was very much the former. That was a very easy decision for me. The challenging part was being an honest assessor as a shareholder. I think you always have to look at yourself as a shareholder. I think I've bucked the trend of most founders in that I stayed as the CEO through many of its iterations. I mean, to the point where we had 150, 160 employees and three rounds of funding and all that type of stuff. This was my decision on a personal level and on a professional level to say, listen, I'm not sure I have the same drive, the same energy level, the same gear that I know we need. We were on the verge, and our CEO, and I'll talk a little bit about Mark in a minute, has done a phenomenal job of the next phase of scaling. I knew the type of energy that would take, and as a shareholder, I looked myself in the mirror and said, are you the best guy for this job? I said, can I do it? Absolutely. I had no fear that I could do it. It's, am I the best guy for the job? And that's a question I ask myself constantly throughout the years. So I went to my board and said, I think we need to start looking for a CEO. And they weren't anticipating this. It wasn't something that came down from them. It was, no, you're great, you're great. I said, well, thank you, I appreciate that, and tell me more. But then when we're done with that, I said, I don't agree. I think the next CEO of this company has to have seen international expansion, who's got more experience in alliances, who's taken companies public, who's scaled human capital at a level that I never have. Can I do all those things? Absolutely, I believe I can. But I'm not willing to bet my shares in this company on my success versus someone that's done it before. So the best thing was we embarked on that journey together, myself and our board, knowing that we were not going to settle. And what was really cool is it was an unbelievably cool experience to find the caliber of individuals who were interested in this job. We'd built a great company in a great space that had a great reputation. We did, in fact, create a category. We didn't intend to, but we did, you know. And
or at least tell you what to raise money.
Until we were to raise money. Then we had to. We had to come up with a three-letter acronym. And so we had wonderful interactions. You can ask any of the directors of our organization. Our two investors are Sterling Partners and SAP Ventures. Both have been incredible partners. Sterling from day one in 2005 when they joined our team. My biggest criteria was stuff that was inside. It was the DNA of the individual, the heart, the soul. Would they treat this company and its people like I did, like I wanted to, like I continued? By the way, Drew left the company to go sit on a beach a little bit back in 2008. So this is a couple years after Drew left. The most important thing to me was the DNA and, of course, the experience. We were very blessed to have Mark O'Connell come our way. Mark O'Connell was and is a very successful CEO, had taken a company called Matrix One from next to nothing to a $150 million company, took it public, sold it, ran it, scaled it, did it in an incredibly respectable way. I got to know Mark, spent a lot of time with him, his wife, good people. And Mark and I think are bucking the trend of founder and hired CEO that butt heads. To me, that just can't happen. So it's been the right decision for me. It's allowed me to be a board member, a director, stay involved in the strategy of the company, but step back a little bit and enjoy life.
So talk a little bit. You talk about being on the board there. You know, talk about what insights have you learned about boards of entrepreneurial companies. You know, what are the good things? What are the things you really want to have if you did it over again? What are the things you want to avoid? What are the insights came from those experiences, both as a CEO and now as a founder on the board?
Okay, so if you notice a theme here, to all the entrepreneurs out there, until you have customers and revenue, would you stop thinking about your boards? Okay, it doesn't matter yet. Get customers, get momentum, and then we. So once you get to the point where you need a board, you've got an investor on, of course, now you have fiduciary responsibility to build a board. I guess what I have seen is, number one, when you're evaluating investor firms, and maybe we'll talk more about this,
we will.
Think about the individuals involved in a deal much more than just the firm. The firm's important, the firm's gonna be critical, but the people that are gonna be on your board, the individual human beings, are like inviting people to your family table. Think about it that way, screen them that way. I purposely caused conflict with Danny Rosenberg, who I love to death, and Jeffrey Moss, two guys at Sterling at the time, just to see how they handled conflict. You know, they may not know it was on purpose, but it was. It's an Italian thing. Anyways, so a good board is one that handles conflict well. I would say, as a entrepreneur and as a venture capital firm, the faster you can surround your CEO with operating experience, the better. Don't get me wrong, I think investment professionals are critical. They're gonna point out things that are around the corner that you never anticipated, but you know what, there's nothing like, as a young CEO who didn't even wanna be a CEO but was just passionate about a space, to have an operator put his or her arm around you and say, here's how I did it, mm-hmm. Here's how I would approach this. Forget some of this advice, this is what you need to focus on.
Fred Wilson has a great post on that where he's on a board and he said, he's obviously the venture guy, he's never been an operator, and he said, you know, one of us is plenty, would become redundant after that. You may have to have more than one if you have more than one round of funding. He said, but you know, we don't bring insights like the operators do. And I think that kind of insight of operators and especially entrepreneurs who've walked in that, so valuable. Yeah. I mean, that's why you're such a great
director. Great example. Sterling Partners was an investor in a firm called Vocus. It's probably one of the original and very first SaaS IPOs. One of the reasons we wanted to raise money, again, we raised it when we didn't need it, but by the time we closed the deal, we kind of needed it. was to build a world-class data center. So Sterling Partners, knowing that, said, you know what, one of our seats is going to be taken by the CIO, founder and CIO of Vocus, who we never scaled a data center. I mean, we had some really big companies working off a server in our office. Thank God they didn't know that. And statute of limitations has worn off on any suits for that at this point. Thank you. We had a world-class CIO taking a company public, built a world-class SaaS company, sitting there working in an operational role with us at the board, helping us scale out a data center. That was huge. And I credit Sterling for having the wisdom to know that, and me learning that's the type of board member we need. And by the way, the company evolved and it's scaling, and that CIO, a gentleman by the name of Bob Lentz, he and we both knew that the fit probably wasn't right anymore. And so he stepped away and said, you know what, you guys need to go in a different direction. You need to get somebody who's an operator in a particular area. So I think the science of board management and art convene around people that you click with, that will challenge you. There's nothing worse than having a board meeting where people agreed with everything. It's like, kind of boring.
In case you can't tell, he never agreed with anything I've said in the meeting.
Pat's like, yeah, thanks. Someone's going to sharpen it.
So talk a little bit about getting funding, because you know funding is one of those things that you have to do at some point if you're going to be a scaling startup typically. And when you do it, it's a big decision, and you're married.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit about that process, what your experience was, what you and Drew learned, yeah. And what you would think of if you were them. In addition to the person being, you know, the most critical piece, the woman or man you get on your...
There's a lot of lessons here. I think what I'd say about funding in general is I'd never done it before. I never knew I wanted to be a CEO. I never knew how to raise money. I think if I took a finance class at Kellogg, I probably was doing my marketing homework in the back row. So I really didn't understand that world very well. What I knew was my space. I knew we had a company that was interesting, and I knew we would be needing money pretty soon if we wanted to achieve some of these goals we had. I went out the very first time. First of all, I didn't have time to write a business plan for a company. We were too busy kind of building the business. We never had a business plan, and I don't mean we didn't have a plan. I just mean we didn't have a plan. I actually hired one of my old bosses, the guy that hired me at Sundance Homes, because he was doing consulting at that point. I said, would you write a business plan for me, you know? So he went off and wrote the 80-page gnome, right, or you know, tome that we all want to have and deliver and seem really cool with. It was so brutally off from where the business ultimately went, but we had something to hand over. And I went into that very first meeting with my boots shaking. I thought I was going to have to sell so hard, and these people weren't going to like me, and they were going to call our baby ugly and all that type of stuff. And when I started saying we sell to the top line of organizations, we got a recurring revenue model. This is 2004, okay? These are our blue chip clients, ADP, American Express, blah, blah, you know. I kind of learned within the first 10 minutes that maybe the selling was happening in the other direction, okay? And that was very fortunate. By the way, we'd been in business. The number one thing that was compelling to the VC community about our business, I wasn't some known CEO. I wasn't like a two-timer, or three-timer proven entity. We had managed to bootstrap a company and make it profitable through the dot-com crash. That told them about as much as they needed to know about me and Drew, that we weren't going to waste money, that we were sharp, that we knew our market, okay? That was a big thing on their end. Second thing is we probably had 20 first conversations in the venture capital community here in Chicago, which, by the way, you're also fortunate to have such a better ecosystem here in Chicago today for raising money than we did. There was like four firms that you would want to talk to in Chicago at the time, and we were blessed to talk to all of them. And interestingly enough, we got term sheets from all of them. Term sheets from the Valley and term sheets from Boston. So literally I was like, this is going to become my full-time job. We made the immediate decision that if that happened, our business would die, you know, in terms of revenue creation and keeping customers happy. So we culled it down to four firms. And we didn't even know how much money we were going to raise. We went wild swings. Do we need $2 million? Do we need $10 million? You know, I mean, it was kind of these wild swings. We were probably the worst prepared raisers of money. In fact, Danny Rosenberg and I have gone for the last 7 years, or someone from Sterling, back to Kellogg, where we both graduated, and taught a class about that fundraising process. We actually give them the first business plan that we sent. And I hide in the back row of this class for the first half. They don't know who I am. And it's funny how these Kellogg students will sit there and go, who's the CEO? Where did they get these numbers? These financial projections are brutal, you know? I mean, they're just ripping on me, you know? They can't do this. And their management team, there's no pedigree, right? And Danny says, hey, that's great. And they rip apart the plan, and they see who would invest, who wouldn't invest, and you get a little bit of this. And usually, like, 20% say they would invest. And Danny says, cool, we're going to take a break. And then after the break, John Aiello, the CEO, is going to come on up. and it is the coolest experience because he's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm like, you're getting a C, D. Yeah. But the lesson to the venture, and these are all folks who want to be venture capital investors, is look beyond the business plan to the business. Is there a legitimate business there? Have they proven that they can get things done? Are there significant and different exit possibilities? In other words, if the business plan is we're going to sell to Microsoft someday, amen, I hope you do, but if that doesn't happen, we're all dead. If all those check boxes, SAVO had check pluses in. And it's a great lesson in terms of the reality of it. And then Danny, I will tell you, Danny Rosenberg, and I keep mentioning his name like I'm plugging him, and I am, he knew my biggest fear and Drew's biggest fear about raising money. And it probably is a fear out there for all of you as you're thinking about this, or will be. It works. Me and Drew just worked. You know, when we made decisions, we shut the door, we whipped erasers at each other, and we came out with a decision, right? Now we're going to have a board meeting? What's a board meeting? I've never been in a board meeting. And so Danny was brilliant in his own sales process. He would have these engagements with us. He'd talk with us. He'd ask questions. And it was this real comfortable conversation. And he'd go, by the way, John, we just had a board meeting. And I'd be like, seriously? Cool. And then he'd show up in sandals the next day, which felt good. And I was like, okay. And so he sort of demystified the process of the interaction between the venture capitalist and the firm. I knew right away after those type of interactions that Sterling was the right partner. And that's who we went with. And frankly, you know, through our second round, they were our only investor as well. And that partnership is so critical on a personal level and a financial level. So
before we go to three questions. I always ask at the end here just to get your insights on to share. lessons learned, things when you look back, you'd say, boy, if I ever did that again, not that you're planning to, but if I ever did that again, I would always do this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, lesson of, boy, I'd never do that again. Mm-hmm. What are yours?
I think it's a good question, Pat. I think the thing I would say about I would do it differently or I would never do that again, I fought very hard the idea of bringing on a senior executive into our company that focused on human capital acquisition. And I kind of thought, we don't need an HR person, you know, come on, we don't need HR, we don't need a couch, I don't need people complaining, you know. And our investors constantly pushed me, John, you gotta be thinking about this, John, you gotta be thinking about it. And I just couldn't frame up the ideal person in my mind. A few years ago, we brought in a human capital executive into SAVO, and it's been light years of progress in terms of scaling an organization. So I think earlier on, I would overinvest in a human capital acquisition and growth expert. Because particularly in a market like Chicago, we've got great advantages, but finding the very, very best people isn't always the easiest thing. And as a CEO, you want to know who's coming into your company, you want to know who's there, you want to talk to them. You got to have somebody on the front lines who's extremely capable of doing that. So that's something I would have done differently. I think it would have helped escalate our growth. Did you ask me what I...
Yeah, top thing you do again, like, well, I'm so glad we did that. Do that 100 times out of 100.
So I am a salesperson by DNA. I love selling. I could sell what we do today. In fact, I'd love our Chicago Terry. If Mark's looking to hire anybody, I might lace them up again. Even though I had done that and I had built sales teams, I hired a head of sales that I couldn't afford way before an organization normally would. And I think organizations that do that, yes, you're a founder, yes, you're a crazy good seller, but if you can't figure out and bring somebody alongside of you who can leave a trail of process in your wake and begin to train others to actually do the stuff that you do innately as a founder, you're dead. You won't scale. So absolutely hire a head of sales that's proven, that's actually entrepreneurial, test that, long before you can afford it. In fact, we hired a very senior head of sales a year and a half before we raised our first round of capital. And the first time I looked at that salary, I was like, oh my gosh, it's going to kill me, right? And best decision I ever made. And so over hire in that regard.
Great.
Revenue makes all the problems go away, Pat, I believe.
I agree with that. So that leads into an interesting question we get into, which is probably different now, obviously, than it was when you and I started. But Chicago for entrepreneurs, having started and built a company over the last almost 15 years, 14 years here in Chicago, what are the pros of having done it in Chicago, and what are the cons of having done it in Chicago?
Yeah. I'll tell you, the pros far outweigh the cons. I'm a Chicago person, and I will tell you, there's something about the DNA of Chicago that is built on substance and not sizzle. And that is something that formed the foundation of who we were as a company. Frankly, we sometimes, to our detriment, didn't have enough sizzle around what we did. We were all about legitimate, substantive, let's build a business the right way, hands in the trenches with our customers. Chicago, its support team, even though today we have 1871 and the CEC and Kevin's leadership and how this thing's growing, we didn't have that back in 99, 2000, 2001, 2003 when we were starting to scale, all that type of stuff. But you know what? There were individual human beings that made themselves available to us who never said, go for the sizzle at the expense of substance. So I think that alone forms a DNA. And by the way, our customers knew that about us. They knew that about us, and Chicago sort of represented that well. ton of other pros. We have major corporations in Chicago who are willing to take a risk on people that don't have business cards yet. Okay, I mean, the likes of thank God, Citicorp Diners Club didn't ask me for like a Hoover's report or something like that, you know, and thank God Northern Trust, right, 160-some-odd-year-old organization said, yeah, we'll take a chance on you guys. LaSalle Bank, right, now B of A. Early clients, we have organizations, and they're even more willing to do it now, are willing to take a chance. By the way, they're not willing to give you a chance. They're willing to give you an audience, okay, and that to me is really incredible. I would say in the valley out east, these are wonderful entrepreneurial environments, but you know what? This community has been so welcoming of what we did. Now, there's cons, obviously, and I think the major one is access to specific types of talent. I don't mean access, I mean quantity, okay? I mean, in some arenas like technology product management, and really looking at technology marketing, I think we're wide but not deep. I think you can find people. We are very blessed to find somebody early on in our evolution that got it, okay? And SPSS was a great recruiting ground for us, quite honestly, when they were here. You have to work harder to find talent. And I'll revisit my earlier point about what would I have done differently. I would have gotten somebody to help us find talent that knew what they were doing. I wasted so many times in bad interviews. I made bad hires. I spent too much time
doing it. But it is hard because there's a tendency early on for an entrepreneur to say, well, they seem like they have these kinds of skills. You know, they worked at Wrigley, and that seems like a really good marketing organization. And then you get there and you say, doing B2B software, innovative, disruptively innovative software, is not anything like doing brand management for Gum.
No, it's not.
And part of the challenge is there just aren't enough companies who've done this enough to sort of grow our own at a large enough number yet. And I think that is a real challenge. I don't know how we solve it quickly, but it'll certainly happen with more great companies.
Well, I mean, first of all, I think you can find great people here. I just think you need to work really hard at it. It needs to become an aptitude of your organization. And if you're serious about scaling, you need to have that aptitude. Secondly, I would say, don't let that potential con or restriction of the Chicagoland area stop you. I mean, there's ways of scaling your organization that don't require the person to be sitting next to you, obviously. So make sure you define the role right. The other thing, too, is and I guess this is a con, but it's clearly changing, and I think 1871 and CEC is doing this, is getting people who understand what it's like to actually work in an entrepreneurial company, okay? I mean, you go out to the Valley and people have experience at doing this. They know that when they come, that no one's gonna send their fax for them. I know there's no faxes. No one's gonna, you know, do this or that for them.
You're dating yourself.
I know. but they actually know what it's like to be in an entrepreneurial organization, which I define as making so many decisions every day with incredibly imperfect information.
Right.
Are they really comfortable doing that?
Well, I see that a lot where people will say, they'll liken a small business to a startup. Mm-mm. And I think somebody once described it as the dollhouse theory of companies, that essentially a startup is like a small version of a big company. You know, startups basically exist, you have this innovative idea, you're trying to solve a problem, you got an innovative way to solve this problem, you're trying to prove that it can work.
Right.
You're trying to figure out how to make it work as well as possible, and then if it works then, try to scale it. If you get the revenue and customers to scale it. That whole environment and how you do it is nothing like.
Right. And you got to be careful because there's, especially now with 1871, there's an incredible cachet and coolness and hipness, and I won't date myself with any of my other adjectives, but there's an absolute cachet at groovy. It's groovy. It's groovy to work with entrepreneurs. People want to, hey, I'm part of an entrepreneurial thing, man. And people will get good at communicating to you in their resume that they're entrepreneurial and they get it. you have to be really good at screening these folks. One of the things I always did, if, see if somebody's really entrepreneurial-minded, was I'd say to them, all right, cool, so what's the most important financial statement to an entrepreneur? And they'd say, oh, it's profitability, it's the income statement. And I go, no, see ya. It's the cash flow statement. If you don't have cash, you don't live, you know? People that could answer that question, no matter what functional role they were in our company, I knew that they'd get it. And they'd ultimately treat my company as if it were theirs, which is really the threshold I was looking for.
Let me go to some questions here that have been, and if people want to vote, you have more things to vote, I'm happy to take them in. So go back kind of early on. How did you figure out the right pricing for both the service and product?
Highly technical process, Pat. Not quite that, but...
Add a zero. See what happens.
I will tell you, pricing for us was a little bit different than most SaaS companies will experience because we were not going with the $19.99 a month version. We were selling a SaaS product ultimately to big companies who didn't want per user per month pricing. They wanted enterprise pricing ultimately. So pricing was a journey for us. You know what? I don't have any brilliant insight on that other than you have to be a student of what the market will bear. You have to be willing to say no. Which after you get your first few clients, you should be able to say no. Don't say no the first few times. Get those clients. But ultimately, you have to be able to say no. And if you've done a good job selling your value proposition and you can communicate the actual return, that's why some of those third-party things help. You know, if I could say to somebody who's saying, I want it for this, I'd say, well, hang on a second. You know, it's not me telling you that you're going to get 10x on this investment. It's these guys. Call them, you know. And I don't need the 10x, but I need 4x, something like that. So
when was the time, one of the questions is, when was the time that you decided... We're not going to, we can't scale this thing if we keep accommodating everybody's requests. We're not in the custom software business.
Right.
When did you sort of make that decision, and was it hard with the clients who'd grown accustomed to the responsiveness?
Yes, it was hard to those clients, for sure. We really made that decision when we raised capital. You know, we had the SaaS business, the mansion by way of room addition, and we knew we needed to raise money, so we raised a lot more money than we thought we needed, which is one of my best practices in raising money. If you think you need this, raise that, because first you got to pay your lawyers, and then there's a bunch of stuff you didn't expect. It would be my 2 cents on that. So that was the time we decided to scale, and we rebuilt the technology, and we went and had hard conversations with some of those early customers. And thank God we built great trusting relationships with them, because we never lost them.
When you had a consulting business, some people have had a consulting business or think about that as a way in. What advice would you give them if they wanted to sort of turn a consulting business into a product or spin it off and create a product? What would your advice be to make that work?
Well, it's going to take you longer than you think. You have to be in a strong financial position because if you're really hurting for cash, the first time someone offers you cash up front for a consulting type project, you're going to say yes, and you're going to distract your roadmap and your development stuff. So be in a strong financial position. I guess the one piece of advice, it's a real positive piece of advice, which is don't like shift your brain entirely. Like, we were a consulting company, now we're a SaaS company. Use your consulting background to be a uniquely and differentiated version of a company in that space. I mean, I will tell you, there are people who are companies who do something like SAVO in the market. There's nobody that knows the space even remotely as close to us. And that goes back a decade now to domain expertise that we built in the consulting practice and in our early customer relationships informed our roadmap and made us really good at getting buy-in from senior people who didn't know they had this problem. So we went from a consulting company to a consulting company with a SaaS product to a SaaS company with a killer consulting practice. And that's the evolution I would follow.
So a couple questions about product. First one is, you know, when you look, eventually you got competitors. Who are those competitors? And how does SAVO differentiate today and continue to try and, you know, keep a lead that allows you to be as successful as you've been in the past?
Still to this day, our biggest competitor is do nothing. So it's still an evangelistic space. If you look at the deals that SAVO's sales organization is working on today and the ones that don't close in a quarter where maybe we forecasted them to close, by far and away, 70, 80% of them are closed, no decision. So it's not closed, lost. We lost to this one or that one. It's closed, no decision, which is good and bad. It's good because they're not dead. It's bad because, wait a minute, we lost to nobody? You know, is sort of the obvious question. So that still is the case today. What I found was we approached the problem of sales enablement very holistically. We had a technology that could help salespeople from the early parts of their sales process all the way to the end and beyond as they were doing account management. Every part of their content needs and data needs we could push to them. There were point solutions that could handle proposals or could do presentations or could do competitive information, or the whole social for the business craze was the most recent one, which I think has fallen somewhat flat on its face because it doesn't actually deliver any value, but that was the latest point. Oh, we can give you a social platform. What we found ourselves in, I think, in a competitive disadvantage is we were selling this Cadillac and other people were selling like tires, okay? And people were ready to buy tires as opposed to the whole car. So a lot of the evolution through Mark's leadership through the organization today has been, let's keep the Cadillac and let's begin to be able to parcel out the different parts of it as people are getting there on their journey. So now we go head to head with some of these folks on the point solution. We do it with a consultative mindset, with a holistic differentiation, but we can now sell little bits and pieces of the grand solution, and nobody can package the whole solution like we do.
And one question people have been voting for here is, how does SAVO know what info to push to a salesman? Who enters it or ties it? How do you make the connections?
Cool.
How does it really work?
Great question. Really two things. Number one, if it's integrated into CRM, which increasingly is the case with our customer base, SAVO takes the metadata from opportunity records, so who you're talking to, where you're at in your sales process, who your competitor is, and uses that as informing the right information to get pushed out to you. Think about this for a minute. Pat asked if we're competitive to CRM. No, we're quite complementary. What incentive does a salesperson have to keep an opportunity record up to date with just CRM? Well, the incentive is they don't get paid. Pretty good incentive. But their boss is telling them, you got to do this. They don't actually get any value from doing it. With SAVO integrated, if they keep that stuff up to date, the stuff that they need is smarter, better, faster, and at their fingertips in seconds. So metadata from CRM, and again, the synergy loop here works. Second thing is the technology itself is smart. So what your best people are using, the most frequently used stuff, the stuff that's working in the marketplace, inevitably through search technology that we've built our own algorithms on, the right stuff bubbles to the top based on its use and effectiveness by your fellow salespeople. So it's smart. And then there's, of course, marketers on the other side. It's kind of like doing a Google search, right, where you got sort of the organically searched stuff that bubbles up to the top based on its incredible value as proven. And then there's sort of the paid search stuff that's right there. If the marketer says every time someone, or a content creator says every time someone searches on how do we beat this competitor in the market, I want this asset teed up to the salesperson no matter what. So it gives marketing a reason for being present in the sales organization as well.
That's great. It's really cool.
It's a great question, by the way. A
couple of personal questions before we wrap up. This won't be a Jerry Maguire kind of thing, don't worry.
5'9".
So one is, how do you find...
With gel.
How do you find your talent?
Sorry?
How does one find their talent in what they're trying to do? Like, what? How did you find your
talent? Own talent?
Yeah.
Like, how do you find your sweet
spot? Oh, no, sorry. Let me read this a little closer. Sorry. These questions
are not very personal.
Yeah, exactly. John, deep in your soul, what do you think you're really... No, I'm sorry.
I was three.
How do you find the talent you're hiring? When you're looking for people, as you look at developers, marketing, sales, do you have different strategies for them? You talked about having the SAVO way of doing it. What is it about what you do that's different?
Well, it changes as your organization scales. I mean, early on, so I'm teaching this class at Kellogg, and it's been a joy. It's called Entrepreneurial Selling. And I think people think, I'm just taking this because I want to learn how to sell it to customers, and amen, that's good. You are a salesperson in everything you do as an entrepreneur. If you can't sell to your first employee and get them to take a leap of faith with you, you're dead. I mean, you won't be able to get them. So you got to sell the passion. You got to be passionate, visionary. I'm going to stop at nothing to succeed. So you got to be a good salesperson there. But as the organization scales, that all changes. I mean, we did it through hard work, sweat, and I would do it differently as I talked about earlier. What's really cool is once you get to a certain point, and I think Mark and Jane Seitz at SAVO have done an incredible job of building a self-fulfilling engine. I mean, it's now become a destination place to work because it's not just, we're not just working people hard. We've got SAVO gives back, people doing things in the community together. People are philanthropic together. They're having fun together. They're seeing success of a company together. And today, it's a lot easier, I think, to recruit people to a growing successful company. So I think we could spend a lot of time on that. It's obviously on people's minds. As soon as you can afford it, get somebody to come alongside of you and help you do this. Because if you're a great visionary founder of a company, you probably aren't the great visionary recruiter of people. You got to be the closer, okay? But get somebody to screen who knows how you think, who knows how you feel.
When you were at the heart of your entrepreneurial work and rhythm, what was your day like? What was your morning routine? You know, the question is, what time did you wake up? Did you work out? Family time in the office by? Like, what was it like? How did you, what worked for you?
I'd roll out of the bar about 2 a.m. No, that's not true. It really is your entire life. I mean, so I'm an early riser, and
3 a.m.
There you go.
Somebody got an email at 3 a.m.
Oh, regularly. Yeah. So I had my little pocket. So when my wife and I were blessed to start our family, I said to my wife, I will be home every night for dinner if I'm not traveling. And so what happened was I had an immovable object at the end of my day, which was you need to leave now, which meant the early part of my day just kept getting earlier and earlier and earlier. And I'm not kidding you. I literally would get up at 3 a.m. and I'd have my pocket of like 2 hours of uninterrupted time. And I'd email everybody around, you know, the company.
Send them faxes.
I'd stick my letters in the mail with the stamps. Thanks, Pat. Note to self, Pat's next board meeting. But I had my time there. I commuted from the suburbs downtown. Now, I would leave my home at about 5 a.m. because I'd drive. Because usually, by the time we had a sales organization, I knew that either in the morning I'd have to talk to our sales team out east, and in the evening I had to talk to my sales team out west. So it was easy to be in my car and not annoy people on the train. And so my day, honestly, was that. And when I got home, my day actually during the day was insane. It's as fun as you could possibly imagine. As I said, it's like making really important decisions with imperfect information. And if you're not comfortable in that environment, then hire a new CEO quickly, because that's some of the joy. But honestly, it was like all in. Early on, it was mostly customer interaction. And then later, and some of this was also contributed to why I felt maybe I'm not the best guy at this anymore. I loved interacting with customers, and the bigger your company gets, I have found the less and less you do that. You become more involved in some of the other things. So great days.
One last question we always ask here, as we look at Chicago's burgeoning entrepreneurial community, companies younger started in the last few years that you're excited about, you may have been exposed to one way or another.
Yeah.
They get you excited to go, that could be a really cool company for Chicago.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of them. And it's been a blessing to be part of CEC and do office hours with young entrepreneurs and all ages, by the way, but companies that are young and visionary. There's a few. I think the caliber of founder CEOs in this town right now is extraordinary. Like, way better than me or Drew ever were. I mean, seriously. You notwithstanding, Pat, you are clearly still...
Well, what we're seeing now, though, which is interesting, is there are a number of successful entrepreneurs that we know, I won't name names here, but who have been very successful, who are doing it again.
Yeah.
And so there's an interesting group of people in their 40s who've been successful entrepreneurs who are going again.
Yeah.
And, you know, they kind of start on base in terms of their knowledge. It's going to be really interesting. It's kind of the opposite of the 25-year-old.
Right.
But it's going to be really interesting to see that happen as well.
I'd say I'll highlight three. Company called Base CRM, originally called Future Simple. It's an investment that OCA Ventures made, and the CEO there, a fellow by the name of Uzi. Many of you may know him. Brilliant guy, burning passion for reinventing the CRM space, for actually adding customer value. Incredibly innovative business model, and it's been a joy to watch what he's doing with his company. I think about Iris Mobile, a company that I've got the pleasure of getting to know some of the guys there, trying to reinvent the way that, you know, handheld marketing happens through interactive media. Highly innovative product, but these are guys who aren't 22 and 23. They've been around the block. They've hired an incredible head of sales, I believe. They got a great founder, a great CTO. They're doing things right, and they're going to grow, and they're going to reinvent the marketplace. And I think of some guys out here from Black Sheep, a media company. kind of taken an old school, you know, traditional way of communicating, newspaper, and kind of turning it on its head and reinventing that. So, I mean, there's just endless. I mean, everywhere I go, I'm asked as if I'm some really smart guy. We spend time thinking about my company. And I always tell people, I've done this once. I'm probably not doing it again. I have one set of experiences. I'm happy to share them. I'm happy to give back with no agenda, and I don't want anything in return. And what I learn is that they're giving me, generally speaking, more than I'm giving them. Inspiration, vision. God, I wish I was that smart when I was doing this stuff. And then there's things that inevitably they ask really good questions. And so I think, I got to tell you, it'd be cool to look 4, 5, 7, 10 years from now and realize some of the investment, both in people like us, Pat and Kevin, and some of the folks around here who've been around the block who are investing a lot of time and energy helping, and to see what these folks who have taken our help but then put their own stamp and vision on doing these companies. I'm pumped. I mean, I got to tell you, asking somebody 10 years from now what are the pros of being in Chicago, I think you're going to hear very different answers.
That's right. Well, you know, as someone who's had the benefit of your insight as a board member and as a friend and fellow entrepreneur, it's really great that you're sharing that with so many others. It's really generous. And thank you for sharing here tonight. This is
my pleasure.
Thanks,
Jim. Cool. Thanks.